Gentlemen and ladies and gents, just a video. It turned out that I reset some things on a computer last night. I had to take care of some driver issues. And when I did that, it reconfigured my audio. And when it reconfigured my audio, the last video didn't record any of the talking I was doing for a whole hour, an hour worth of talking. Ladies and gentlemen, I gave some very good information at the end of the video, and I don't remember what I said. So I can't give it to you this time. Sorry. And it had everything to do with the issue that's going on in the background. I took the video down because there was no reason for it to still stay up there. Ladies and gentlemen, there is something known as a maximum law. Does anybody know what a maximum law is? If you do, raise your hand. Aren't you not too smart? Raising your hand to a computer. You got problems. Oh, Lord, Lord, Lord. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, a maxim is a foundational principle in law. I only deal with foundations. I only deal with principle. I only deal with logic. If it don't make logic, it don't make sense. You can go ahead and quote me on that because I've been saying that since I was 15 years old. Okay? That I know for a fizzak. Okay. Now, you know, as a matter of fact, I changed the audio. So let me take a look at the audio. This is the software I'm using is ZDSoft.com. Ladies and gentlemen, ZDSoft.com is pretty all right software. I'm turning the volume up just a little bit, and then I'll check it later to see if it's okay. Then I can adjust it from there. You know what I'm saying? Well, why couldn't you just adjust it after the video? Just shut up. Okay, now,
why are you going to tell people to shut up all the time?
Because people are always talking, so they need to shut up.
Oh, okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, this legal maxim means that the law does not compel a man to do that which he cannot possibly perform. Historically, a person who entered into a contract was bound to perform according to his or her promised duties, regardless of whether it became impossible to do so. Thus, early courts did not recognize this, but they do now because it is a law. The law does not compel a person to do that which he or she cannot do. It is the law. Okay. No one has a duty to do what is impossible. This maxim has been cited in, for example, and it gives you the several different cases for which the law had been cited. Okay? This is a maxim. You cannot be made or forced to do what is impossible, no matter what the contract says. Ladies and gentlemen, what's one of the impossibilities that they're trying to force you to do? At the end of this explanation, then I'm going to explain that to you, and then I'm going to read something to you. This video is going to be better than the last video because I was getting ready to do this video after I did the last video to show you what I came up with as a result of the last video, the line of thinking. See, what I'm doing is I'm working on something, and as I'm working on it, I'm sharing it with you. I'm not working on it and then doing it and then wait until I get some success in sharing it with you. No, we're going to take this journey together. If you all will notice something, I'm different than those other people out there. Okay, I'm very different because, see, they keep the stuff to themselves. So they, well, if you want, I charge $185 billion an hour and blah, blah, and blue, blue, blue. And then I don't give you no promises, no guarantees, no nothing. I just take your money and I run on. I was listening to a young man speaking at the Kingdom Hall today, and he was discussing honesty and how, as a Christian, Jehovah's Witnesses must be honest in all things. Ladies and gentlemen, you constantly hear me tell you, first, I don't beg nobody for no money. Don't want your money, don't need your money, don't care about your money. You do whatever you want to with that junk you want to call money, okay? Just that simple.
Well, since you don't charge, that's why I come to you.
Oh, no, you got the wrong idea. Because I say I don't want people's money, that doesn't mean I'm going to do your stuff for free. That doesn't mean I'm going to do your stuff at all. That doesn't mean I'm even going to touch your stuff. You know, as far as I'm concerned, you're MC Hammer. And you're singing that song to me all day long. Can't touch it.
Can't touch it.
That's all you're singing all day long. Okay, because I ain't going to be bothered with you. I don't have the time. That video that I just did, the one where you couldn't hear me say a word, I was talking about how tired I am and how I was going to go lay down for a moment because I've been working on papers all day. Got papers around me, papers to the left of me, papers to the right of me. Hey, Mary J,
you going to be doing that? I'm going down. Huh? You think you're going to sound like Rolls Royce?
Huh? Let's see if you sound like Rolls Royce.
You've been away, boy.
Y'all, she does sound like Rolls Royce, y'all.
And the sound of the rain.
I'm sorry, y'all. That's Mary J. And she's talking about slowly. It's slowly driving me insane. Girl, I'm going down. Okay, Mary J. Blige singing that wonderful, wonderful, wonderful song by the original, the Rolls Royce. And they were talking about how they were just going down. That's right, they're going down to the village, going down to the city, going down to the beach, wherever they were going. She talked about doing that because she was just so tired. Ladies and gentlemen, the legal maxim, no one could be made to do the impossible. As I said, the information you're going to get here is more than the information I was given in the other video, so it actually kind of worked out. As though I am tired, so I'm going to try to rush through this without rushing.
Oh, you're a Russian today. Mama, he's a Russian. He loves Vladimir Putin. Putin. I mean, if you had a stuttering problem, he'd probably have you assassinated. Uh-huh. That's what Vladimir does. Vladimir is a very, 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 very violent man. Just like that Trump fella. Everybody gonna see what Trump is about.
Oh, I'm sorry. Would you get out of this conversation and let us finish? Always gotta put your little 10 cents in everything. Shut up. Shut up. Sorry about that, everybody. All right, let's get back to explaining to you guys what's going on and why we're bringing up how you can't be made to do the impossible. Somebody kicked you out of your home. They shouldn't have kicked you out of your home. Somebody foreclosed on you. They said you owed a debt. Ladies and gentlemen, I need you to understand that no law can compel you to do something which it is impossible for you to do. Let's find out what was impossible. According to, and I opened up this whole window, new window for you guys, so that I did everything in this window, and I'll do that from now on. That way I don't have to be worrying about showing people's emails or anything like that and having to redo things. But Senate document says that the ownership of all property is in the state. Now this individual so-called, pay attention, they said it, I didn't. So-called ownership is only by virtue of government, i.e. law, amount in the mere usury. This is where you get individuals talking about usufruct. That's right, it's not a bad word. It's actually a legal term. It just means that they give you the right to use it even though you don't own it. You've heard people talking about how the DMV owns your automobile, how you only have a title to the property, but you don't actually own the property. You have a certificate of title and not an actual title. Your title is colorable title. Well, this is the reason why they say that, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, we're just getting around to explaining it to you, but we need to give you the reasons for why people say that the DMV owns your property. That's why you don't get the MSO. That's why the DMV gets the MSO, because it is the law.
But the DMV is a private organization.
Yes, they are a private organization doing the work of the Secretary of State, the administrative branch of government. It really is that simple. All right, let's see if we can give you some more education, okay, ladies and gentlemen? Pay attention. Under the new law, the money is in return for government obligations. Well, the government hasn't given you money. It's given to the banks. See, the money is issued to the banks in return for government obligations. What government obligations are they talking about? People, in return for your mortgages. Oh, you didn't know. Oh, I'm sorry. I have to show it to you. That's right, because I showed it in the other video. That means I'm going to have to show it in this video. Okay, let's go step by step. First, what's impossible? Well, you can't own any land in the United States. It is impossible because the government owns all land. Then we're going to go to this section right here because this is necessary. But we need to understand, what is money?
Money. Is Federal Reserve notes construed as money?
No, because Federal Reserve notes are not redeemable in gold, silver, or any other commodity and receive no backing by anything. Now, this word is a serious word. It would have been by anything except they didn't do that there, did they? Okay. Now, wait. In another sense, what other sense is that? Nonsense? Because that's what it... I'm sorry. Anyway, the notes... Uh-oh, I didn't know we were going to get that loud. Hold on. This right here is... That's Anthony Davis, y'all. I kind of liked it when it first came out with him, but he was kind of loud right there. Okay, anyway, let's get back to this. Ladies and gentlemen, Federal Reserve notes, the Treasury have already said that it ain't worth nothing. They ain't backed by nothing. Okay? Y'all not doing that to me. I done turned his volume down and he's still loud. Hold on now. We down to 10 already. But I can hear the volume. Y'all can't. I didn't turn the volume up on my end. I turned the volume up on their end when I did that. So in the program, I didn't turn it up on Windows, but they're kind of loud to me, you know? Loud to me, so it must be kind of loud to y'all too. This right here, section 411, that's this right here, 12 USD, that's in 411. That's what they're talking about.
This would meet the requirements of section 411, but the government would also take over the assets. Pay attention. It becomes the ownership of the government. Look, they're saying exactly what they said in the act. So nothing has changed. Congress has specified that the Federal Reserve Bank must hold collateral equal to the value of the Federal Reserve notes that the bank receives. This collateral is chiefly gold certificates or United States securities. Birth certificate, and your mortgage. And your Social Security account. I didn't say this, they said this, United States Securities. This is under the United States Securities Law. Social Security Law, the Security Exchange Law, okay? Those are the securities laws, people. This provides backing for the note issued. Hold on, because y'all can't see it, okay? Because it is backed by the credit of the nation and it represents a mortgage on all the homes and all the other property of the people of the nation. The Treasury is telling you exactly how things work. Right here at the Treasury website. Listen to what they next, okay? Hold on. The idea was that if Congress dissolved the Federal Reserve System, the United States would take over the note liabilities. No, that wasn't the idea. They weren't talking about dissolving nothing. Not with 411, they won't. Okay, this would meet the requirements of Section 411, but the government would also take over the assets, which would be of equal value. What assets? The collateral, which is all the mortgages and all the property of all the people of the nation. The Federal Reserve notes represents the first lien on all assets of the Federal Reserve banks and on the collateral specifically held against them. See, they represent a first lien. So the Federal Reserve banks are first lien holders on the collateral held by the Federal Reserve notes. Now, I don't think so. Because guess what? You can't use Federal Reserve notes to pay the Federal Reserve. We'll talk about that in a minute. That's the impossibility. Oh, and by the way, the other impossibility is the United States does not have the right to give your property to the banks to hold as collateral. Do you know why? Because you needed to get something in exchange. Remember, the people traded in their gold in exchange for what? The Federal Reserve having a lien on their properties? I don't think so. Okay. Give and take is what it is. You guys know the law. The law says that if there is consideration, and there was consideration, collateral, using the people's property as collateral, there must be value given to the people. What was the value given to the people? Absolutely nothing. So I think I've come up with a way for those people who have lost their homes to bring forth an argument and to do it in such a way by documenting everything every step of the way and challenging everything every step of the way. Let's find out. Acceptable forms of payment. You know, you go to the bank and they say, we'll only accept payment in this form or that form. Say, acceptable forms of payment, cash. Can anybody tell me what the definition of cash is? Now, wait, before you go on, let me let you know there are two types of definitions. There is an economic definition, that's right, and there is a legal definition. So I don't want the economic definition because according to the Supreme Court in Thompson versus Butler, as far as market value, one is of greater value than the other. But as far as money, that is to say, notice they said it, I didn't. Let's do Butler versus Thompson. Want y'all to know there ain't no such thing, according to the Supreme Court, as cash and law. Just need y'all to understand that. We got Butler, B-U-T-L-E-R, B, period, Thompson, T-H-O-M-P-S-O-N. Hey, look, it already had it. 1877, 1877.
999-4488-100. Call us tomorrow. We'll be here.
Oh, it's not Butler versus Thompson. It's Thompson versus Butler. T before B, except after B. Come on, Butler. Come on, Thompson. See, Thompson versus Butler. Let's see what the Supreme Court says cash is, because this case is still precedent. That's right. It's the precedent of the United States of America. Okay. A coin dollar is worth no more for the purposes of tendering payment of an ordinary debt. Now, remember, Congress spoke about an ordinary debt in the so-called Joint Resolution 192. There is no such thing as House Joint Resolution. It's officially called Joint Resolution of the Gold Repeal Act, or the June 5th and 6th Act of 1933, but it ain't called House Joint Resolution, so y'all stop with that HJR junk. That's why y'all getting laughed at, because that ain't the title. Well, anyway, enough about that. The law has not made the note a standard of value any more than the coin. Now, don't pay attention to the word coin. They're both equal value, the note and the coin, because they're both dollars. Anyway, it is true that in the market, as an article of merchandise, one is of greater value than the other, but as money, that is to say, a medium of exchange, the law knows no difference between them. Please understand, legal tender has no value. It is not money. You see, it is not money. Cash is not money. Cash money! No, it ain't money. You all need to understand. But they said, that is to say, a medium of exchange. The law is no difference between the two of them. However, hold on, don't y'all get off of that horse. Shouldn't be sitting so high. The notes are not redeemable. They receive no backing by anything. They have no value for themselves. Wait, hold on, wait a minute. The Supreme Court just said the same thing, didn't they? It says, the law has not made the note a standard of value more than a coin. That is true in the market as an article of merchandise. One is of greater value than the other. But it says the law knows no difference between them. But the Treasury just said the same thing. It says it has no value because it's not backed by anything. See?
Receives no backing by anything.
But notice what they did say in another sense. Wait a minute. What sense is that?
Nonsense.
Nonsense? Oh, you're so funny. In nonsense, because they are legal tender, the Federal Reserve notes are backed by all the goods and services of the economy. Ladies and gentlemen, he's right. The Federal Reserve notes are backed by all the goods and services of the economy. Pay attention. Pay attention. It will represent a mortgage on all the homes and other property of all the people of the nation, including the immigrants.
That's why even the immigrants, even the so-called undocumented Fabians.
That's right. Undocumented Fabians. I don't know why they keep calling them undocumented. They got documents. They got many documents. They call them undocumented. That's stupid. That's stupid. That's just one of them terms them little stupid, little ignorant people come up with. Hey, Genuine is talking about stingy. Genuine. Tell them about stingy. I can't hear you, Jim. I can't hear him. Oh, I didn't ask for that. What you doing? Y'all see this right here? I didn't ask for that. That's like my printer. Okay, that's what I thought. I don't want Scan Doctor. I didn't ask you for that. Close. Okay, where you at, Genuine? Okay, couldn't hear Genuine. But this is my other song, y'all. This is The World is a Ghetto. I gotta go and edit this song later because the end of it, like 5 minutes, no sound. But I thought Genuine was gonna play because I wanted him to tell y'all about how y'all just stingy, you know. But anyway, let's get back to this dollar bill junk. All right, now, legal tender has no value. It's represented by all the homes and the banks literally have first lien rights on the assets of the Federal Reserve. But remember, they're not the assets of the Federal Reserve until they're the assets of the government, because the government owns all property. So the government has first lien, the bank has second lien. But you notice, I want you to understand, this is the Treasury talking about the lien thing. That's why you have guys talking about there's a lien on the money and we pay interest on it and all of that stuff. That's why you have them talking about that, because they're going here. This has been since 2011 that this has been up. But again, we're looking at this a different way. We're looking at this way so that you guys will understand. Acceptable form of payments are cash, money orders, paychecks, bank checks, MasterCard, Visa, Discovery, and most debit cards with the Visa or MasterCard logo. Please make all checks payable to the DMV. For security purposes, cash is not accepted at the photo license centers. Oh, look at that. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it's cash money. Cash money! Yeah, cash money. They like Murder, Inc. Cash money and Murder, Inc. had a little rivalry going on. We're not talking about that type of cash money. Sorry, ladies and gentlemen. Apologize. They just keep popping up out of nowhere. I don't know where they be coming from. I didn't send them to sleep, but they just keep waking up. Guess they hear me here talking to y'all, and they just want to be a part of the fun. This ain't fun. I really need to get them to understand this ain't no fun, okay? Now, the biggest thing for all of you to get is they're saying you have a debt, that you owe a debt. This is a banking holiday. It's impossible. All debts have been suspended. This is bankruptcy. This is bankruptcy. United States declared bankruptcy by the March 9, 1933 Act. Do not go into court saying that. We're going to give you a script. Do not go into court saying that. Because no matter how much is the truth, they will take it, twist it, and turn it around, slap it up, flip it, rub it back. Oh, no. Okay, anyway. They will do that. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the act that was here. Let's go here. This is going to tell us what legal tender is. And remember, this is all according to the Coinage Act of 1965. So that's where you, if you're going to do some research, you're going to compare the Act of 1965 with the Act of March 9, 1933. Okay. Now, this is something that you need to know. Did you know that there was a Legal Tender Act of 1862? The Legal Tender Act will let you know whether or not your bills of exchange are construed as legal tender and whether or not you can use them in the course of tendering payment. The Legal Tender Act of 1862 will let you know whether or not your bills of exchange, your money orders, your promissory notes are legal tender as defined by statute, not as defined by the courts. The courts don't get to determine what is legal tender. The law determines what is legal tender. But you have to know what you're talking about, and you have to be able to stand on your square when you're speaking to these idiots. Because they tell you guys some wonderful things. They don't tell me the same thing. They don't come at me with that crooked stuff because I knock them off their feet every single time they do. Go ahead. His name is Marcos Lopez. Magistrate judge thought he was intelligent, thought he could sit up there and hold his own. And see, ladies and gentlemen, unlike you, I ask setup questions. I don't just be walking into that courtroom acting like I'm stupid.
Would that be good? You're stupid?
Shut up! I make them think that I'm playing right along with their little game. And then, again, like I asked that psychologist. Oh, by the way, too many people have been asking a psychologist about where to get his law degree since I did that stupid video and letting you guys know back in 2013 that the courts are saying that he doesn't have to have a law degree. Well, again, it doesn't matter what the courts say. He doesn't get to determine whether or not you understand the law if he himself is not a student of law. And if he's not a student of law, then that calls his so-called judgment into question. But what I've told everybody since then, when you get the psychological evaluation, because that's their only weapon, you cooperate and you act like you ain't heard nothing about nothing. What you talking about? A trial? Man, that's just a jury, a judge, and a prosecutor, and a defense attorney. And the prosecutor's job is to sit up there and put evidence to try to convict the person who's been accused of a crime. And the defense attorney's job is to represent the best interest of his client to make sure his client gets off. But he's not supposed to violate the law in order to do that. And the jury, they're supposed to sit up there and judge based on the evidence and the facts that they hear during the testimony that's given. Yeah. And then whatever verdict they get, that's it. And then the person gets to appeal, and they may get, I think they get like 14 days to file their appeal, notice of appeal. And then after they file their notice of, oh, you don't want to hear no more? Well, I mean, because I can tell you what happens at the appeals court, and I can tell you what documents need to be filed with the appeals court. And then I can tell you how many judges are in the appeals court. And then I can tell you after that, it goes to the Supreme Court. And then if it's in the state, then you get to appeal it to the federal district court. And then you get to go to the circuit court. Oh, you don't want to hear, but I thought you wanted to see if I knew what was going on in the courtroom, dude. Okay, you tell them what everybody else would tell them. The so-called psychological evaluation is not there to determine what you believe, why you believe, how you believe. It's there to determine if you are competent. Guess what? If you're irrational, if you are argumentative, you are not competent. That's why many of you lose. So you go in there and you cooperate and you play like you're part of the Matrix. Oh, and the sky is just so crystal blue, even though there is no blue sky no more. You just tell them the sky is so crystal blue. And look, the birds are singing. Nope, we're in the year of 2085. There is no more birds. And the birds are singing and the trees. There ain't no more trees. 2085. Okay, but you tell them what they want to hear. It doesn't matter if they
say, well, he was just telling me what I wanted to hear, or she was just parroting something she heard on the internet.
Because as long as you're able to articulate the fact that you can remember to repeat something, then that shows that you're competent enough to remember. It's a catch-22 for them. But everybody whom has called me and told me they were having psychological evaluations, I have told them what to say. In other words, to cooperate, they have listened
to my legal advice.
And not one of them was found incompetent. Nobody yelled or screamed at them. They just went on with the proceedings. So, just to let you people know. Now let's continue with this. This is the paragraph that you are going to need to get a better understanding of, because this paragraph, look, ladies and gentlemen, this whole document right here by the United States Department of the Treasury, it tells you everything you need to know. Honestly, okay, watch and see what we're gonna learn right here. Watch and see. Whoa! Anyway, both the United States notes and the Federal Reserve notes are part of the national currency and are both legal tender. Yeah, okay, whatever. Hold on, we're not gonna talk about that. We're gonna talk about the United States notes, we're gonna start here, were redeemable in gold until 1933, when the United States abandoned.
Get out of here, we don't want you here in our mouth. Get out, you're just sitting up eating up all my food and going to my restroom and smelling it up. Get on out of my house. I don't care if you're only 5 years old, get out.
Okay, the United States abandoned since then, pay attention, the United States notes, Federal Reserve notes and the United States notes had the same value. But we just learned that since 1933, they have no value. Okay, both currencies have served essentially the same purpose and have the same value. Because the United States notes serve no function that is not already adequately served by the Federal Reserve note, the issuance was discontinued and none have been in place since January 21st, 1971. But look, United States notes, we don't care about what they were characterized as. They issued them, these notes, directly into circulation. And they are obligations of the United States government. Those United States notes, ladies and gentlemen. So we need to find out what currency is, y'all. Do y'all want to see what currency is? Let's go down. We got one more section. Oh, wait. Come on. Straighten up. Not there. Just a little bit more of this junk right here, and then we finish with this section. It says, this provides backing for the notes issued. And remember, this would meet the requirements of Section 411. So we do know that the government does redeem government obligations because they are there to fulfill the requirements of the statute. But remember, the statutes are written in advance for specific reasons. Now, let's find out what is cash. I asked all of you, did you know what cash was? So let's see if we can find out what cash is. Let's go here and see if we can find out what cash is. Now, we're not going to read all of this. Please. You think I want to spend the time reading through all of this? Pay attention. 31 U.S. Code 5318. Compliance exemptions, and summons authority. You won't see the word cash. You will see the word money, but you will not see the, wait, hold on, let me do that. Let's see if we see the word cash. Zero of zero. Look at that, cash does not even appear one time in a statute that talks about cash. Hold on, it don't talk about cash, talks about money. Mm-hmm. 19 times, but not one time does it mention cash. Oh, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't do this in the last video. I've never been to this code before, not that I remember. And I never did this about looking for whether it said money or cash. I just know cash is not money. Okay, that's why I've been holding on to it this whole video. I know for a fact that cash is not money. Every time I hear somebody use the term cash, that's a generic term, people. That is not a legal term. It doesn't exist. The laws where the Congress is talking about legal tender does not mention cash. But look, it mentions money. Okay? It mentions money. So, hold on. It mentioned funds. Y'all see the word funds? It mentions funds, but it don't mention nothing about no cash. So that's why I asked you to explain the legal definition of money. I mean, excuse me, of cash. And so what I'm going to tell you is that there is no legal definition of cash. You have these websites, they'll add in all these other things, okay? They'll add in all of this other stuff, all of these other words, trying to say this is what it means based on some general meaning. But ladies and gentlemen, no, it don't work like that. There's a lot more of the money. Hey, do we know what this one says? Federal Deposit Insurance Act? Oh, yeah, we know what that junk says. Nobody cares about that junk. Hold on. Might stumble on something. That's why I'm doing this. I told you I ain't read this. Okay? Nope, ain't gonna stumble on nothing. That's the end of it. Back up to the top again. All right, that's it, ladies and gentlemen, as far as that's concerned. So now we know that, again, if you look at the Coinage Act, if you look at the Legal Tender Act, you'll see that your promissory notes are money. They are redeemable notes. And since the government owns everything now, they are redeemable government
obligations of the United States government.
Okay. I'm not saying that. Congress said that when they took away your ability to pay your bills. Sorry. They gave legal tender. You, and again, the Coinage Act and the Legal Tender Act. That's, I'm not looking for the Coinage Act right now, but I'm telling you guys, do your research on the Legal Tender. The Coinage Act and the Legal Tender Act we'll cover right now. Hey, Patty, you're a little loud. And I got you at 15. And ladies and gentlemen, when I first heard this song, I was traveling on the road, and me and Patty, I'm loud with it when I'm in my car traveling on the road. And me and Patty, we could blow. Okay? That's the name of the song. Y'all don't believe me? Hold on. Okay? Only Patty or somebody like Patty could name a song. You know, and it'd be a hit for her, okay? But of course it was going to be a hit. Ladies and gentlemen, take a look. The Legal Tender Act passed February 25th, 1862.
On this day in 1862, Congress passed the Legal Tender Act to finance the Civil War.
Really? Then how come, according to the Treasury, pay attention, the Legal Tender Act was passed to finance the Civil War. United States notes characterized by the red seal
and the serial number
were the first national currency authorized by the Legal Tender Act and begun
circulation during the Civil War.
The Treasury issued those notes directly into circulation and they are obligations of the United States government. Issuance of the United States notes is subject to limitations established by Congress. Where? Pay attention. In the Legal Tender Act. Because they then made legal tender legal. And they gave it a definition. What was the definition? Well, let's go ahead and see what the definition is.
Political.
I know where political is. I heard of political. Y'all heard about political, don't y'all? Y'all know about political? We gonna go to political. I don't wanna go to, what's that stupid place? Wikipedia.
Okay. But see, political is not going to give me the actual act. So I want the actual act. I want the...
Whoa, did you see that? I didn't know this, ladies and gentlemen. All this time, I did not know this. In 1870, the United States Supreme Court, in a 4-3 ruling, declared paper currency to be unconstitutional. The majority opinion, written by Salmon Chase, the Chief Justice,
found that Congress had violated the Fifth Amendment guarantees against deprivation of property without due process of law. Isn't that what I've been saying? As wartime Treasury Secretary under President Abraham Lincoln, Chase had played a key role in authorizing the greenbacks issued by President Lincoln. So again, the court has ruled, pay attention, the court has ruled that having that money represent a mortgage on the property is a denial of individuals' due process right to property. Didn't somebody say that in a video? Didn't somebody already tell people that without even reading this? Because I already knew. But we're going to talk about that in a minute, okay? Okay, we're going to talk about that in a minute. Oh, by the way, hold on. Politico, you guys are not that bad. The act legitimized paper currency in payment of all taxes, internal duties, excises, debts, and demands of every kind due to the United States, except duties on imports, and for all claims and demands. And it should also be lawful money and legal tender in payment of all debts, public and private, within the United States. Do you see what the law legitimized legal currency, paper currency, and made it good for the payment of all debts, legal tender for the payment of all debts, public and private, within the United States? Now it's without the United States as well. But I'm not interested in what Politico is saying. Like I said, I don't want you guys to read an article like Politico. I want you to read the actual act. In 1870, no, not that one. I'm looking for this one right here. On the same day the court ruled, President Ulysses S. Grant nominated two candidates to fill judicial vacancies. They were confirmed by the Senate. In the next session, the tribunal agreed to revisit the greenback issue and reverse the earlier decision and apply the court ruling that held that the Legal Tender Act to be justifiable use of federal power during a national emergency. Interesting. Interesting, huh? Interesting. Interesting. The court reversed itself, says that it was a justifiable use of federal power during a national emergency. Where have we heard that national emergency thing? Does anybody know where we heard national emergency? I know we've seen national emergency someplace before. So as I told you, the Supreme Court ruled the same as I was saying, that they cannot just take your property and do whatever they want with it. But the Supreme Court came back and said the United States can sit up here and create paper currency and do whatever they want with paper currency. That's fine. But hold on, during a time of war or during any other time of national emergency declared by the president. Do you see they're using that term? National emergency to do everything. So now you can highlight the fact that we're under a federal and a national emergency. Because remember, the Federal Emergency Act, Federal Emergency Relief Act, is May 12th, 1933, and the National Emergency Relief Act is March 9th, 1933. Again, they keep declaring these emergencies, people, and the emergencies declared by the president in 1933 are still extant. That's what I'm trying to tell y'all, so that's what y'all need to be aware of. Okay, y'all needs to be aware. Now, we still got some talking to do, and I want to go, I thought it was going to be some more political. Y'all, I know political because they have some all right articles. I don't agree with everything at political because political is one-sided, okay? At Pennsylvania rally, Trump endorsed himself. Yeah, mm-hmm. Of course he would do that. Of course he's stuck on stupid. I am stuck on stupid because the president's stuck on me. Hold on. Let's do this. T-E-X-T. I want the text, okay, dude? Just give me the text and nothing but the text. Like Joe Tex? No, not like Joe Tex. Like Fax Domino text. But Joe Tex and Fax Domino came out around the same time. They just liked it almost the same thing, but they just really didn't think the same things. I know. Now look, I asked for the text and it pulled up the same stuff. So it sent me back to Wikipedia. Dagnabbit. Break up to make up, y'all. That's all we do. First you love me, then you hate me. So what I'm going to do is ask you guys, remember, the Supreme Court has ruled that the Legal Tender Act is the act that documents what is money, okay? You'll see that cash is not mentioned. in the Legal Tender Act, and the normal, common, everyday definition does not apply, because the normal, common, everyday definition also implies that bills of exchange, like the Legal Tender Act and the Bill of Exchange Act, said are legal tender. Hey, 12 Stat 345, enacted during the Civil War. We know that anytime, because remember, they enacted something during that Great Depression. So we know that anytime they do something during the Civil Wars or other wars, that's only as a distraction for the rest of the people. We do know that. Okay. Now, we can get rid of the acceptable forms of payment. I'm going to invite you guys to go look up the legal definition for cash so that you'll see for yourself that what you thought was cash is not cash. Okay? And we're talking about how is cash defined by Congress, not how cash is defined by a legal dictionary. So that's what I did in the other video. I looked up how cash is found defined by Congress. Ladies and gentlemen, do you see Library of Congress? Okay, do you see Library of Congress? Well, I'm going to need a few of you to do me a favor. This is what I said in the last video, and I couldn't remember Library of Congress in the last video, so I'm glad I remembered it now. I'm going to need you all to do me a favor with respects to the Library of Congress. I need this right here, Senate Report 93-549. Now, that report might be lengthy, okay? That report, let me say it again, might be lengthy, but we need this information here because this lets us know that they did something illegal. This is their own words. I'm just going to tell you exactly what we're looking for. They said that Congress delegated to the president extraordinary powers. Well, separation of government does not allow any branch of government to delegate its powers to any other branch of government. But Congress said that these powers taken together confer and delegated enough authority to rule this country without the Constitution. That's what we want. That's the first thing. We don't need this part right here. This part doesn't do us any good, okay? That part doesn't do us any good. What we already know that it did not apply. We need this part right here, 502 Section A. The provisions of this act shall not apply to the following provisions of law and powers and authorities conferred thereby and actions taken there under Section 5B of the Act of October 6, 1917, which was the March 9, 1933 Act. We need that. If you send it to me, I'll make it available to everybody. Okay? Now, I need this one as well. Senate Document Number 4373, Congress. This can be gotten from the Archives Department of Congress, the Congressional Library. You can actually order this. Don't need it certified, people. I just need a copy of the actual document. And I'd rather get it from them than from the internet, because you know how they change stuff? Because it's the internet. I need the Congressional Records of March 9, 1933, House Resolutions. Got to get rid of that joint stuff. House Resolution 1491, page 83. But I'd rather get page 80 through 87, the surrounding pages, because we need to know more about the subject matter. Because I promise you a lot more was said during these hearings, and this was back in the 1930s, when they knew nobody would go back and look at the record. So they weren't like they are today, where they really go out of their way to hide things. This wasn't the case back then. They didn't go out of their way to hide things back then. So if you all want to help get me these documents, I'd rather get them from the source than from all over the internet. I know people are going to try to get them over the internet and going to send them to me, and you're just going to be wasting your time and mine, because I need help in acquiring them from the actual source. Why? Because with them coming from the actual source, nobody can contradict it. With them coming from the internet, again, people change things. You guys need to understand, a lot of the stuff that's put out there on the internet, a lot of the stuff that you're thinking is new, a lot of the information you're getting from these new booties on the block, that ain't the actual information. That ain't the legitimate information. That's the bull stuff information. Okay? Because they add, take away, and they put in all kind of stuff that ain't even nowhere near the law. I've already did at least two videos where I say, look, it didn't even say that, and people have been saying that this and all. Okay, so I don't go by what people say. I go by what it actually says in the law. Now, let's go here, and then we're going to tell y'all the argument that we're going to be bringing before the court from this point forward. And it has to deal with this. We don't have to go to the last one. That's Butler and Thompson. Thompson and Butler, excuse me. Ladies and gentlemen, with regards to... I've been asking people this question all morning. Okay, because the angle I've been going at is no one can be asked to do the impossible. Remember this. When you trade on the market, you are taking a risk. Okay? Now notice what they say here on this site about taking that risk. If it's gonna let me, let's do this. Okay. Market risk is the possibility for an investor to experience losses due to factors that affect the overall performance of the financial markets in which he is involved. Market risk, also called systematic risk, cannot be eliminated through diversification, though it can be hedged against. Hedge funds. So you can actually vote against or vote for your stock going up and up and up. Or you can actually vote against it going down, 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 down. That's where they get them for insider trading. That's why you can't know insider secrets, because you can bet against yourself and actually be rigging the market to where you win and other people lose, okay? Because it's a risk, that's why you signed a mortgage, but you don't even realize that. You don't even realize that's the reason why they do the mortgage in the first place, because the banks are greedy, they wanna get paid, so they made an agreement with you to let you, let them trade your property on the market. Give me a second, I gotta change something on here because it's got some information y'all ain't supposed to see. So y'all hold on. Ladies and gentlemen, please understand I've not completed this document. I just put this document together. What I want you to pay attention to, listen, understand. Pay attention, listen, understand. I just put it together today. As a matter of fact, right after I did that video, and wasn't even an hour gone by before I started doing this video. So I want y'all to know I haven't had time to go through it and reword it. This is me putting the thoughts down on paper. I'm going to give you some ideas. I promise you that you're going to get some ideas from this. When you get the idea from this, you are free to use it. My biggest problem is individuals have had some success with some of the things that I've been telling them and allowing them to listen to my videos, and they go out there and do. The only problem is when they go out there and do, what they don't do is come back to me and say, hey, look, this is what happened. I got this and that, and they gave me the title to my property. I just got one email from somebody who said that he listened to one of my videos, and he, in listening to the video, did one of the documents and got his car paid off and got his paperwork for his car. Okay. But I'm a little leery because I think that there's more to that picture. I got to move this over a little bit, not too far. Let's bring you up. Yeah, there we go. We'll take over the world, y'all. That's Usher. All right. Whatever the loan company is, on behalf of whatever the bank is, also known as blah, blah, blah. It has come to our attention. Hey, Usher, you go ahead and take over the world, but I gotta let you go. You can go stand someplace else. Okay. On behalf of Chase Manhattan Bank, is whom we're writing this to, but we're writing, this is not the servicer. This is supposed to be, it could be whomever it is, servicer, new owner, this could be the bank. You don't have to do it this way. This is my format. It has come to our attention that there, and again, I'm going between representing the person and speaking in the first person. I have to take the first person out of here. So again, this was just me putting my thoughts down on paper. So I haven't proofread it. So shout it out. Or perfected the instrument. It has come to our attention that there is some confusion in this matter. It is our hope to clear this up so that there is no further dispute. Again, we're using that word on purpose, letting them know that this matter is in dispute. Please note that the loan associated with the property located at, and we put the address, has and or was satisfied more than 5 years ago as agreed upon with the original lender. Yes, we call a controversy saying the original lender got paid. They got their monies. Get the funk out of my face. There's actually a song called Get the Funk Out. You know, I just hate it when people don't believe me. Hold on, y'all don't believe me? We're gonna go here, but I'm not opening up this video because this video I like. This video that I just clicked on, I like this video. We ain't going here, okay? We going right click, open up new window. We going here. And I'm just gonna type it in because I know when I said that some of y'all didn't believe me. I'm a music connoisseur, especially when you go back to the 70s. Oh, Mr. Witherspoon, you left Jamie Foxx speechless? I don't believe that, but if they say he did, give me 1 second. Y'all, I was looking at the Rob Ryder one, so give me 1 second while it caught me off guard just a little bit. So we're going to get the F-U-N-K out of my face. Get the funk out of my face. Get the funk out. What? Get the funk out of my face. Tell me I don't know what I'm talking about. When I tell y'all I know for a fact, there's a song called Get the Funk Out My Face.
Hi. Hello.
Okay. This is Brothers Johnson. I'm gonna stop the Brothers Johnson. You see, they played real instruments back then, you young folks that don't know nothing about music. Okay, so let's get back to the document, okay? Again, we mentioned dispute because we're bringing up the fact there is a dispute. We mentioned the original lender because we're bringing up a controversy that the original lender received the funds, but we're also making that part of the argument. It has come to our attention that you are utilizing the trade name, either collectively and or separately, of either the name of the party. This is a loan that has two people's names on. You are hereby ordered to cease and desist any such encroachment and or trespass immediately. It was our understanding that when you signed, or when we signed the loan docs, that we were receiving or were to have received a loan whereby interest was being assessed. Was this not correct? This assumption, because that's what we say, it was our understanding. It is also our understanding that upon signing the loan docs, we also signed a document known as a mortgage, or known as the mortgage, and that the mortgage, see how we put it highlighted, and the note are separate documents, i.e. separate agreements. Is this not correct? They cannot deny that the mortgage and a note are separate. They're not the same. Okay? Remember, the mortgage must follow the note. They must stay together. They do not stay together. That's what I'm bringing up. That according to the agreement, the loan was approved, yet there is no indication in any documentation as to the species or the form of the loan. Is this not correct? Yeah, what did you lend? What species of currency did you lend the funds in? Because by law, I'm required to pay you back in like species, unless something else is specified in the agreement. Just hold on. According to the agreement for the loan, the original lender was to receive repayment, and this is supposed to be in, again, no proofread, in like species. Is this not correct? But you just explained it. I know. I'm just letting you know where I'm headed, you moron. According to the agreement.
Oh, I like it when he does stupid things like that.
The mortgage document, which is separate from the loan document. See, the mortgage documente, no S. Which is separate from the loan documents with an S, loan docs, was to place a home that I acquired and or purchased as a result of the loan. That didn't read right. So I think it was to place a lien But yeah. Yeah, was to place a lien on a home that I acquired and or purchased as a result of the loan that I had previously received after being approved. Is this not correct? Again, I'm saying that the original mortgage doc was to place a lien on a home that I acquired, which was a previously purchased prior to the signing of the mortgage doc, because the mortgage doc and the loan docs are separate docs. I signed the loan docs first. That's why you sign those first, because you're purchasing the home first. Then you're using the house as collateral. Basically, what you guys are not understanding, you cannot put the house up as collateral for the loan because you don't own the home. That's like me saying, oh, and by the way, here's a $200 down payment. I'm going to pay you the rest of the money for your car next week, next Friday. And then I go out and I put up your automobile, which I only pay $200 of a down payment, no ownership rights, just $200 down on the down payment. And I'm sitting up here going ahead and saying, I'm going to take out a loan on your car and I'm going to use your car as collateral. You can't do that, people. All of you thought that you put up your home as collateral for the loan, and you did not. You didn't own the home. You received the loan first. That's the loan docs. You got approved for the loan, so you could not use the home as collateral because you had to get the loan first before you could own the home. So one could not happen without the other, which means the house wasn't the collateral, people. They have been misleading you into thinking that you put the house up as collateral for the loan. The house is not collateral for the loan even to this day. You didn't put anything up as collateral. That's why they talk about your signature. You gave them back that note, which they were supposed to take to the treasury, but that's not your argument. That's not our argument here. Our argument is, you'll see in a second. I just wanted to explain what we were just explaining there. Now we're going to talk about you people going into court and saying all this stupid stuff. There's been some confusion over the years of somehow mixing facts with conclusions and presumptions and assumptions. For instance, the mortgage was to place the house as collateral, not for the payment of the loan, because that would nullify the original agreement, as the original agreement specified that the loan was approved prior to the acquisition of the home, which by reason and standard of law, the home could not be used as collateral for the loan, which was acquired prior to the purchase of the home. Look at the procedure in the official record for the process. The official record shows exactly what happened. You signed the loan docs first. Then you signed the mortgage document placing the home as collateral, not for the loan. And that's what you're not getting. Pay attention to your documents. It does not say that you're placing your house up as collateral for the loan. That is never what it said. It never said that yesterday, and it ain't saying that today. You're going to see where we're going in a minute. And I promise you, you're going to like it because nobody else has done it this way.
Calm down. Calm down, dude. I know it's a lot of information. I know it's important what you're trying to tell them, but you don't have to be that excited. You're going to have a heart attack. Number three, so calm down.
Sorry, ladies and gentlemen, the information that I'm trying to present to you and the argument came about last night when I got word that the Ninth Circuit Court wanted to play games. At first, I was going to have several people out there who knew something about the law file a lawsuit challenging the March 9, 1933 Act as unconstitutional and just have them doing it for several different aspects of this country and then have somebody going into the Supreme Court under certiorari. As a matter of fact, QTAM, I didn't even think about doing a QTAM before the United States Supreme Court. As challenging a statute. Wasn't even thinking about that. Have to think about that later. Can't think about that now. It's too much on my mind. Let's continue if you don't mind.
No, I don't mind, sir.
Okay, we're going to continue. And yet, there has been a belief that the loan was for the home. If that were the case, that would mean that the bank owned the home. which would be an impossibility since the records clearly show the previous homeowner whom I purchased the home from, and it was not the bank. So once again, the loan was for personal use, i.e. a personal loan and not for a home as presumed by so many. Are you guys getting it now? Your paperwork shows that you purchased a home from a previous owner, not from the bank. So the loan was not from the for the home. Do you need to get a better understanding? Go back and look at your paperwork. Look at the fact that you got a loan and you purchased the property with the proceeds, but still you purchased the property not from the bank. So the bank did not give you the loan for a home. I don't give a if they call it, I gotta stop doing that. I don't care if they call it a home loan. That's a misnomer. It is not a home loan. It is a personal loan. The law calls it a personal loan. The IRS classifies it as a personal loan. You need to understand it's a personal loan. The mortgage was my agreeing to allow the original lender to trade my property on the market in exchange. The original lender and or its assigns applying all monies due me as an investor and trust interest holder, TIH, to be applied to the balance of the loan. That agreement appears to have been breached, and I must hereby demand all proceeds from the trading of my property in the market immediately. Hold on, y'all, we ain't there yet. You're just about to get it. You are hereby ordered, commanded, and directed to cease and desist any and all trading on my property and or interest with respects to the above aforementioned property, henceforth, forthwith, immediately. The problem is I have not received the full and accurate accounting. You appear to have received not only the tax incentives, tax relief, but you also received tax credits and you failed to document the account as required by the agreement. You knew the terms of the agreement. You knew of your obligation under the terms of the agreement, and you either through your agent and or directly collectively made the choice to defraud me and did so in violation of securities laws, revenue laws, schemes, and other edifices. And I demand a margin call immediate. Margin call. Let's highlight margin call, shall we? Let's make that Boldy Locks. Boldy Locks? Are you sure you want to say Boldy Locks? Boldy Locks. Immediately, with respects to the security and the associated pool that it's associated with. That's why it's associated pooling. You are commanded to notify the securitization trustee, the securities intermediary, the middleman, the FTC, the SEC, and the CFPB of these allegations and of your culpability and or lack of transparency without delay. We mentioned you're notifying these agencies and or other responsive parties as part of the requirements of your being registered with the Security Exchange Commission and the agreement that you have with the Federal Trade Commission. It is also believed that you're in violation of the agreement in terms of the probation reached in 2014 or soon thereafter and or are culpable as a result of being an accessory to financial commercial securities fraud event. We ask that you take these allegations seriously, despite the fact that we are in an existing banking emergency, serious national emergency. Ladies and gentlemen, the idea here is, pay attention. These banks, when they trade on the market, they're registered with the SEC. They have a securities intermediary. They have a securitization trustee. They are also, because they're trading, they have a Federal Trade Commission account. Okay, they also have a middleman, especially since they're dealing with trust accounts. Because they're dealing with securities, they have a middleman. And they're dealing with the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Because they're dealing with all these agencies, they have contracts with all these agencies. These agencies require them to report any claim. Do you understand? See, responsive parties as part of your requirements for being registered with the Securities Exchange Committee and your agreement commission and your agreement with the Federal Trade Commission. It is believed that you're in violation of probation because they're associated with the banks. Pay attention. The bank signed a probation agreement. They are in violation of that agreement. If they have violated securities laws, and if they have done so, They are in violation of the agreement, and that agreement is not a civil agreement. That's a criminal agreement because the probation is criminal, not civil. It's jail time. Now, pay attention. You're in violation of probation reached at that time, and you are culpable as a result of being an accessory to financial, commercial, and securities fraud event. Okay? A financial, commercial, securities fraud event. We ask that you take these allegations seriously, despite the fact that we are in an existing banking holiday, serious national emergency. See, they're doing this during the time of a national crisis, which increases the penalty. Ladies and gentlemen, basically what I'm telling you is that you start off by writing a letter like this to the banks, even if you've been foreclosed on already. That's what this one is going to, an agency who's already foreclosed on a home. You write this letter first, then you do the lawsuit. You do the lawsuit and you bring all these allegations in your lawsuit. We just gave you all of your allegations. This is your allegations for your lawsuit. You put in a copy of your mortgage. Now, by the way, we already showed you as far as currency and legal tender, we already showed you what is legal tender. And if you will understand, if you do not the Legal Tender Act, but where was it? I think it was here. No, it wasn't the stock market risk thing. I think I shut it down. Ladies and gentlemen, I think I shut it down. I think acceptable forms of currencies. That's the one. I thought I shut it down. When you look up the information on acceptable forms of currency, you're going to see that as what's considered legal tender, what's considered cash, your mortgage note is considered cash under law. Okay? Sorry, and if I can't find it now, I'm just too tired to go looking through all of this again. But I didn't look here. Let's see if we can go back. Oh, no, I know what I did. I know it. I don't want apps. I want to go forward. Sorry, my mouse jumps because it's hyper. My mouse is hyper, just like me. Just like me. Hold on. Come on, highlight. Okay. That's when I did the cash thing. So what I did is, let's see, I thought the definition of cash was here. But it isn't. I thought the last search would have been there and I just had to click on it and it'd take me to the exact same page, but it wasn't. So we'll just have to go there. Staple Singer's time. Again, some people are going to get it. Some people are not going to get it. Okay. I remember doing the cash and carry thing, but when we went to the definition of cash, it gave us a licensed sender of money or any other person who engages in a business of transmitting funds. Okay. We don't want no transmitting funds. I'm not going to be able to find it, but in the definition, yeah, I did see this. I did congressional definition of cash. Now we do, let's see. No, we don't want no private banker. That's the research that we don't need to be doing. That's that Tina Turner thing. I'm your private dancer. Anyway, pay attention, ladies and gentlemen. Cash, commerce, money on hand with a merchant, a tender, a trader, or other person in the business or who has a business, the price contracts, price articles paid in cash, contradistinction to the credit price. Common parlance. Banknotes are considered as cash. You see, banknotes are considered as cash, but bills and receivables are not considered as cash. But it wasn't Black's Law Dictionary we were looking for. Ladies and gentlemen, hold on. Now, of course, we know banknotes might be considered as cash. That's what we just read, not the free dictionary, not looking for their definition. I'm looking for the actual definition I saw earlier. Let's go ahead and go to Blacks. I don't like Blacks, y'all. Black is bold and Black is beautiful, huh? No, it ain't. Black's Law is a joke.
I dialed 911 a long time ago.
Ready, money. Whatever can be used as money without being converted into another form, that which circulates as money, including bank bills. Did you understand? Whatever can be used as money without being converted into another form, that which circulates as money. They made sure to use the word circulate when we deal with trading of things on the market. That's why whatever circulates. Because the first thing, whatever can be used as money without being converted, well, all those notes circulate. This is not the one. I wanted the one that actually talked about notes, but here are your cases for what is cash. The only problem is you'll find that, hold on, pay attention. The March 9, 1933 Act, the June 5th, 1933 Act, the May 12th, 1933 Act suspended all cash. All banking activities. So there is no circulating. There are no circulating notes. Banking activities has ceased. Circulating notes is a result of banking. Shh, don't tell nobody. I know for a fact that that's the case. Shh, don't tell nobody. But people got to know that that's circulating notes. It's a banking holiday. You can't circulate no notes during a banking holiday. They're banking holiday. I know, but you can't tell it to people. They're not supposed to know that. But they should know that it's a banking holiday. That means the banks are on holiday. That means they can't do any banking. And we're still under the banking holiday. I know. Hey, cash and cash equivalent. That's where we were. Yeah, I know. I remember. So let's see if we can find about them notes being cash equivalent. No, we weren't here. But cash and assets that can be liquidated into cash very easily. You notice how, ladies and gentlemen, we're looking for the definition of cash, right? And the first thing it starts off by giving us the word in the definition. One of the fundamental principles in the English grammar is you cannot use a word to explain itself. Okay? You cannot use, pay attention, a word to explain itself. And the court saying anything that is in circulation that can be used as money is money. No, that's not what the law says. That's what the court said. Now, the Legal Tender Act said what was that. So I can't find the one that actually gave the note as a definition of the cash. Okay. And I didn't go to U.S. Legal. Important for purchase contracts specified that that there will be a cash purchase or a finance purchase because the two represent. So there's a difference between a finance purchase and a cash purchase. So was your loan a finance loan or a cash loan? That is important to know because that deals with how it is to be paid back because you were supposed to be paying back like species. Okay? So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. I've done what I said I was going to do. I gave you the information. I told you how we're going to be going into court, and I do mean we will be using that in court. You foreclosed on my home and you traded my property in the market and you've collected all of the benefits. I received nothing. I also believe that you've collected on the mortgage insurance. That's what we're going to be going in on. We forget there. Let them have their little party. You want the house? Take the house. But we're going to bring up all of these issues. And you may be able to cancel one. You may be able to cancel two, but you're not going to be able to cancel all of them because they're all relevant. That's what I'm doing here. I'm stabbing them in the foot without them ever seeing me going for their foot. I'm jabbing them in the eye and they don't even see me going for their eye. They can listen to this video 100 times and they still won't see where I'm coming at. Because I see where I'm coming. I can't tell it to you guys fully because
that would reveal my hand.
And I can't do that because I'm helping someone with their property. There is one other thing. Are you sure? Yeah, there is one other thing, but I can't show it to you now. Basically, I have a document, and the one that has my promissory note that you guys saw, the so-called Our Style Money Order, at the top of it, it says, tender of a government obligation as prescribed by the Act of March 9th and March 12th, 1933. It actually says that highlighted at the very top of the page of the mortgage that we're sending in and all of the paperwork and the promissory note. Everything says tendering a government obligation, which you guys need to know that if you're in a foreclosure, you have to tender payment. Okay? You have to tender payment. And when you get a chance, pay attention, because many of you don't like to pay attention when I tell you guys things. You guys like to jump all overboard.
Love overboard!
Shut up.
I'm running out of time. Love overboard! I'm about to lose my mind.
I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen.
That was my dear friend, Gladys, and her knight singing Love Overboard.
Ladies and gentlemen, as I pull up this, because I got to show this to you again, I don't know why it stopped. Come on now. Oh, I see what it did. I like that. It gave me both of the two previous windows. I like that. What this is? This is that wonderful thing known as the... Come on now. Can't even think, y'all. I can't think. This is that wonderful torch.
Yes, I'm exhausted. And I've done a lot today. And I got a lot more to do because I got envelopes to pack tomorrow morning when I get up. And then we got to go mail some things off and file some things. So we were looking for the definition of cash. And so let's see. We looked at legal. L-E-G-A-L.
Come on, come on, come on, come on.
D-E-F. I'm just looking for the court case that I showed you guys earlier. You remember the court case where we went to cash and you saw those different court cases? Well, you saw how the court defined cash. Well, that's what you want to do. You want to explain to them that you paid them in a currency that's acknowledged and accepted by the courts as an acceptable form of payment. Okay? That's all I can tell you for now, y'all, because I know, see, cash sales law definition, I don't want the law. But I want that the one that we, cash contribution law. Don't want that one either, because that's, hey, legal definition. Cash contribution and legal definition. Could that one perhaps tell us what cash is? Nah, this one doesn't tell us about that, but I was pretty certain it was going to be a site similar to that. Anyway, I can go back to the video just like y'all can go back to the video. I just wanted to show you those are the laws that you're going to go by. I just wanted to show you those are the laws you're going to go by. By the way, I was listening to some people might call it a sermon, but it definitely ain't no sermon. We refer to them as talks at the Kingdom Hall. There was a young man who gave a talk, and at the beginning of his talk, he was talking about music. Muzak, people, Muzak! And he talked about how music is the one thing that science cannot explain. They can't. They can't explain where it originated. They can't even explain how music is created. There is not a single person on this planet that can explain to you how music came about, how it is created. Not a single person. There's not a single person on this planet that can describe music to you. Because it's indescribable, because there is no foundational understanding of what music is, because it's different from everybody. See, for instance, I want all of you to think about Row, Row, Row Your Boat. Okay, now see, sorry to do that to you, but now you can't get it out of your head. You're going to try to get it out of your head, but later today, it's going to come back to you again. Row, row, row your boat. When it comes back to you again, you'll say, man, that fool gets on my nerves. Okay, that's all you got to say to yourself is that fool gets on my nerves, because you're going to have row, row, row your boat in your mind. It's a small world after all. There were a bunch of kids and they were getting on my nerves and we were on a long trip and I was a chaperone. Long trip, and I mean long trip. It was 7 hours in that automobile, that van, and they were yelling and screaming and asking questions and getting on my goddamn nerves. And so I said, I tell you what,
you morons, and I called them morons, I called them idiots too, because that's what I do. I said, you morons, you keep messing with me. And I said, I'm going to do something to you that is going to be the worst thing, and I'm not even going to have to touch you. And they said, ah, you ain't going to do nothing. I said, all right, watch this. It's a small world after all. It's a small world after all. It's a small world. For 2 hours straight. 2 weeks later, they were coming and yelling at me, talking about how they couldn't get that stupid song out of their head. I told them, yeah, because it's a song that never ends. Ladies and gentlemen, Row, Row, Row Your Boat and It's a Small World, there are two songs that never end. No matter how you sing it, they never end. They just keep going. And so for two straight hours, all I said was, it's a small world after all. It's a small world after all. It's a small world after all. It's a small, small world. And I just kept going for two straight hours nonstop. It's called mental torture. Trust me, don't do this to your kids. Don't do this to no kids. These were teenagers, and they were getting on my nerves, and these were, oh, God. They were getting on my nerves on purpose because one of the staff members told them to do that. And so they had to suffer the consequences. I told them to leave me alone. They didn't leave me alone. That's what they get. All right, ladies and gentlemen, contributions. This thing says laws and definitions. I thought it was going to give us a definition. Look, it says the grantee's cash outlay. But I don't think it is going to tell us about cash. Do you guys want to take a trip and see if it tells us anything about cash? Let's do that. Let's do the right click and do the Google. Let's see if it tells us anything about cash. I got a couple of minutes before I go and lay down and then come back and finish up the paperwork because I just have to do the addresses and put the things in the envelope and have them ready to be going out.
Tomorrow, I love me. Tomorrow, I'm only a day away.
See, that's what happens when I'm not playing music in the background. Nah, mother. I can't even do that, mother. I can't do none of that no more.
Y'all get on my nerves.
Nope, we don't want this one. I want Cornell Law. See, this one I got to go down and click and down. No, that's not Cornell. I want Cornell Law. Government Printing Office is what that says. Go on now. Wait a minute. Okay, I got 49. I got so many different laws here, but they ain't all the same. I don't want 49. I want 50. I want 18.3. Okay, I'll tell you what. Tell you what, since you want to play, I know how to play. Watch this. See how Google, this is what Google does, y'all. This is what Google does. It has this little stupid algorithm. And Google knows that I'm normally going to Cornell Law. Mess with me. I know how to get it done. And that's why my hope is before the next video is done, I am changing this to 18.3. You see how I didn't pull up 18.3? I don't care about no hazardous material. You see how I pulled up everything but 18.3. And I'm specifically looking for 18.3. And I know Cornell Law has it. All right, so we'll go to transportation. We will go to transportation. Got to transport myself. Hey, guys, it's 4:52. Daylight savings time, and it's still bright outside. It's summertime. Okay, I'm sorry. It ain't actually summertime, but I've been talking to some people on the East Coast, and they were talking about how, they got some weather coming this week and all that, and I'm like letting them know, people, stop complaining. It's summertime. You ain't got nothing to complain about. Just be happy that it's summertime. Uh-oh, it says it's reserved, but those are parts. I'm looking for section 18.3, so I may not be able to find it, y'all, because this is traffic. This is maintenance and all that other stuff, so I may not be able to find it. Yep, may not be able to find it. I was looking for it, but I can't find it, so I don't know. Don't send it to me, people. It's not that important. Recovering debts to the United States by salary offsets. Interesting. 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 No. I really do say interesting that they would even put that in that code. And you see how they reserve sections? Now, why would they need to reserve sections? And that's just the Office of the Secretary of Transport. Now, we know what transport has to do with everything. We know how things are registered, but you guys, at least you learned today why the government owns everything, why the DMV owns your junk. At least you learned that today. Okay? But we're not gonna break away. What we're gonna do is Federal Highway Administration, it says no information available. Administrative requirement for grants and cooperative agreements with state and local grants and cooperative agreements with state and local government. I apologize. Maybe it might be beneficial. And we gotta go down. And we're gonna be here, and it should be taking me to where I need to go. There we go. Definitions. Let's see if it gives us a definition of cash. I believe it just took me back. Yeah, it wants me to pull up the PDF. I can do this one just so that we can find it real quick. Well, golly, Sergeant. Okay, now. Okay, cash overlay, cash contribution means the grantee's cash overlay. Now, notice how they say things like grantee cash overlay. There are 9 times. That's 3 right there that they mention cash. Okay, just the word cash. They may be reported on a cash or accrual basis, cash basis, actual cash disbursement, but they don't give you the definition of cash, people. Let's go back up to the C's because it's 9, and so I can only assure you that this will be number 9. Nope, it ain't letting me do it that way. Hold on. Nope, that's number 8. That's number 9. Unliquidated obligations for reports prepared on a cash basis means the amount of obligation incurred by the grantee that has not been paid. That's not telling us anything. It doesn't give us the definition of cash. And it depends on what your definition of is. Okay, and take a look. Cash contribution, not cash, just cash contribution. We don't know what a cash contribution is. And I need to say one other thing before we dispense this video, ladies and gentlemen. There is this issue where, and nobody told me to say this, this is just me making sure I get it clear because I know I said it already. There is this issue where people are going to think that they don't have to pay taxes. And I want you to know that I never said you didn't have to pay taxes. What I said is if you are a non-taxpayer, there is no requirement for a non-taxpayer to pay taxes. Sorry, I apologize. The reason why I say that is because I must obey Caesar's law. But as I told you, according to Caesar's law, I have to look at the law as it applies to me. And I've gone over the law, and the law has agreed. The officials have agreed that it doesn't apply. And it has not applied. I am willing to have that conversation with them. I am willing to even spend some more time on vacation having that conversation with them. Because by the time I get finished, it will set a precedent. And it will be another, go look up this case if you haven't already looked at it. Economy Plumbing Heating
versus the United States. I believe that was 1942. This one will be 1918, 1919, 1920, whatever year it needs to be talked about. I don't mind. We'll set a precedent. This won't be one of those other people who decided they wanted to get money from people, or excuse me, money. I said money, who wanted to get that legal tender junk from people and not realize that they're not supposed to be using that in the first place, or they should have just, there are so many different things they could have done. But again, they were operating commercially. They were trying to say they were nonprofit. You don't get just to say you're nonprofit. You have to also document your nonprofit. Oh, look at that. The government means a state or local government or federally recognized Indian tribunal government. Really? Is that what government means? Okay. I'm so glad it means state or local government. That government actually means government. That's interesting.
Grantee means the government to which the grant is awarded and which is accountable for the use of the funds provided. The grantee is the entire legal entity, even if only a particular component of the entity is designated in the grant award document.
This is the disbursement to states, but they still didn't mention what cash is. And I guarantee you, in this case, cash is funds. It has nothing to do with dollar bills. I guarantee it. Because what you guys don't get and you don't understand, the government, when it communicates with each other, does not hand deliver cash to anybody. Government doesn't work like that. The government works before it was through procurement and requisitions. They do it with paper. Just like it talks about this grant awards document. That's what they deal with. They don't deal with sending cash to each other. Hey, what is that? Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act. Mm-mm. All right, ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen, ladies, we could go on and see. I think that's what happens to many of you. You get distracted by something like, I just saw that. Now, I could go into that act and see how I can make it apply, but that's not what this is about. This video is designed for those people who've been evicted out of your home. It's not that you can't let it go, but you were done wrong. And you want to make sure that the bank understands that they did you wrong. So, ladies and gentlemen, do a margin call. File the lawsuit. Get the numbers. You already have them. The bank already sent you the pool that your particular note is associated with. Sue the pool along with the bank. Are you listening to me? That would cause a lot of problems with that trading. And now once you sue them, you can demand a margin call, halting that whole process. All you got to do is prove you are who you are. And that was your loan. And that they were trading it and you never got paid and they never notified you. It doesn't matter what they say. You say, I was never notified. You file your complaint, do it as an affidavit. Document everything. You don't have to send it certified mail. Send it priority mail with the tracking number. That shows that it was delivered by a person over 18 years of age, because no one in the U.S. Postal Service is under the age of 18. So you send it by U.S. Postal Service. Priority mail, it comes with a tracking number. That Postal Service documents that that person delivered it. They're over the age of 18. That constitutes a service of process. Okay? This is what the law says. This is not what I say. You don't believe me? Go look at it. Ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen and ladies and gents, that's me speaking for 2 hours and 39 minutes. I gotta go.